Hi, hi everyone. I think like everybody has joined and like there was a technical problem, so there's a slight delay of 2 minutes. We are really sorry for that. So to start with, I welcome all. A very warm welcome to all the vets who are joining this webinar from different parts of the globe. In fact, we have participants from India, Australia, Poland, Portugal, Bulgaria, Algeria, Germany, Philippines, Malaysia, and like even different parts of country like from other countries also. So this webinar is now presented by Natural Remedies Private Limited. I, Dr. Prakash Khangal, Product Manager at PET Natural Remedies, will be moderating today's session of this webinar. So before starting, I'll give few instructions how we can do the webinar in a more productive way. So to make this interactive webinar, there are certain options available for chat, questions, and polls on your screen. So if you are using a desktop or laptop, you can see these options on the right side of your screen. And if you are using a mobile, then you can see these options by scrolling down. You can see at the bottom. If you want to introduce yourself, you can give suggestions, then use chat options. And if you want to ask any question, then please use the question options of your screen. You can ask your questions anytime during the webinar, and we'll be very happy to answer all the questions in the webinar at the end of the session. So after all these instructions, I would like to request Mr. Ayush Agarwal, our business head of PET Natural Remedies Division, to introduce our Natural Remedies to all the participants. What do you wish?
Good evening, everyone. It is an honor and immense pleasure for us to host this webinar for all of you guys with this great speaker of ours. As an organization, our core value has always been to be useful to the society. We at PET Natural Remedies, in association with PPAK Bangalore, is organizing a series of webinars useful in day-to-day clinical practices. Natural Remedies is one of the leading animal and human herbal healthcare company. Presently, our products include medicinal and supplements for cattle, sheep, goat, poultry, and even aquatic life. We are now going to step further to introduce our first of its kind pet and pet friendly range of products for the companion animals. We solely believe in harnessing nature, applying science for health and happiness. For more details, please log on to our website www.petnaturalremedy.com. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ayush. So now I'll request Nagesh Reddy, sir, Secretary of PET Practitioner Association of Karnataka. So please share a few words about PPK Association. Please, sir.
Good evening, everyone. So I welcome all of you to this webinar. I am Dr. Nagesh Reddy, Secretary PPAK, that is PET Practitioners Association of Karnataka, which is affiliated to FACPI, the Indian chapter, and which is again affiliated to VASAVA. So we, the PPAK, thank Natural Remedies, Mr. Ayush Agarwal and Dr. Prakash for hosting this webinar. And before starting our webinar, I want to tell next week, this coming Friday, we are organizing one more webinar. Our Professor Ethiraj, our own patron of PPAK, will be talking on renal failure, that is chronic renal failure, diagnosis and management of it. And now I ask our convener, Dr. Parmeshwar, to introduce the speaker, today's speaker. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening to all. Dr. Parmeshwar here, technical convener, PET Practitioner Association of Karnataka, Bangalore. Respected President Dr. Narendra, the Secretary Nagesh Reddy, patron, other office bearers, and dear Dr. Prakash, and the dear speaker, sir, Dr. Baraninder, and other dignitaries of Natural Remedies. I am so happy to see you all as a first of its kind for us, a webinar. Though we were missing a lot of technical seminar recently, people were very much excited to go for technical seminars as continuous education programs because of this corona lockdown. The situation was not permitting us to conduct seminars in hotels and other places. This has become a useful online learning program And here, I'm so happy that the most efficient or really renowned speaker, Dr. Varanidharan Jiyar, is here with us to speak on clinical approach to anemia and transfusion practices in dogs and cats. Dr. Varanidharan Jiyar, who is a blood bank officer in Madras Veterinary College and also a senior veterinarian in ARC Veterinary Clinic in Chennai, was graduated from Madras Veterinary College in 1997 and also a postgraduate in the year 2000. And point to be noted for all of us is he has undergone an intensive training program in dog blood banking and diagnostic imaging in the year 2012, which really makes him to give a lot of information on this topic for today. And of course, he is also a PhD in 2015 from same Madras Veterinary College. And also, I have learned that from his script, Chipipara, an Indian breed, is now an universal donor having a common blood group in dogs, that is DEA 1.1. And one more aspect regarding the speaker is he has also presented an international paper on oral Carica papaya. We have been using the papaya leaf juice in many cases of thrombocytopenia of different etiologies. But when we look at this paper that was presented by our speaker Bala Varanidharan Jiyar sir, we are so happy to have him here. And it is really, we are very, very happy. And I thank each and everyone who is able to register and join for this webinar today. And I'd like to introduce Dr. Prakash, who is anchoring this program today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. So with that said, sir, now everybody will be interested to know how this webinar, the content goes through. So I request Dr. Varanidharan, sir, to please start with this, sir.
So, good evening everybody, my name is Bharani and I am not so renowned as being praised and just one amongst you. So, today's lecture will be on approach to anemia and practical transfusion tips and practices in felines and canines as we face problems every day in terms of anemia. What is anemia? What happens in the blood cells? How are we going to interfere to make this cat and dog survive the rest of the life? So I have included certain slides that can differentiate anemias, and these slides are laid into several modules, which are very easy. And I need the participants to jot down any points or any doubts then and there. And after this 1 hour presentation, we will surely have a detailed discussion. I don't mind the time because natural remedies is also okay with the time. And so we are going to go a long way in terms of doubts, and I'm also going to learn from you. So I'm very thankful for the Pet Practice Association of Karnataka and Natural Remedies to be in such an effort. Okay, so let's move on to the slides. So I acknowledge my blood bank, which was started in 2010, and the other research projects involved, like the ICR, ICMR, and the DVT centers, that have given me such opportunity to do a lot of things in the transfusion medicine. So I acknowledge my own hospital, my blood bank, my department, and my clinic, and a lot of referral cases that we have within SATAC Veterinaries in Chennai. And one Professor Digger, University of Penn, George Gupas, University of Italy, and Guillermo Couto, the person who has written Nelson and Couto books, University of Ohio. So now for pet practitioners, I don't want to bore them amongst with these very theoretical points of blood transfusion, which does not get into our minds. So I waited to easy modules which will explain the functions of blood, types of anemia, major blood groups available in veterinary practice pertaining to dogs and cats. What is the indication for a transfusion? When you should transfuse
blood? Rapidly.
When you should not transfuse blood? What are the materials and methods that you require for a whole blood banking? What are the materials you require for a component banking? And what will be your decision when to transfuse and what to transfuse? And then we're going to talk about donor criteria, how cross-matching is done on a shortcut basis, blood collection and blood transfusion. If you get any reactions, how are you going to manage? And we are also going to discuss on what not to do. And in these modules, like every module, at the end of the module, you will have some practical tips that you're going to jot it down because it will be very useful for you. So, why is blood essential? Basically, blood has oxygen that is being carried in tissues. So, if there's no oxygen or lack of oxygen, then the patient goes into hypoxia. So when the dogs and cats go into hypoxia, then they become lethargic. So the blood has glucose, amino acids, fatty acids, plasma proteins. The blood helps in the removal of carbon dioxide, urea and lactic acid. The blood also has a lot of immunological functions. The blood also has a lot of coagulation functions. Blood transports hormones, it regulates pH and regulation of the core body temperature. So this is why blood is important, and that is why blood transfusion is important in anemic cases. So the basic cytology of blood, they have different constituents, like majorly we might have learned in the 12th standard of the first year physiology of veterinary science, we just have to brush it to become a good transfusionist. The blood has RBCs, that are the red blood cells, it has platelets, and it has WBCs. So remember, when you centrifuge a test tube with an EDTA, the topmost right and the topmost layer, what you find is a plasma, and the bottom layer after centrifuge is called the RBCs. And the buffy coat is a thin layer that which has the platelets and the white blood cells. Remember, this is gravity. The cells have different gravity gradients. That is why they get centrifuged like this. So the hemoglobin has something called iron in it. Remember, that is why in practice a lot of people think of iron. So the RBCs carry oxygenated blood inside the vessels and they deliver to the tissues directly. That is why when you get a hypoxic case that is having breathlessness, striving for oxygen, anemic mucous membrane, it is no fun in giving 100% oxygen because the animal needs blood. It is already, the oxygen is already available in the atmosphere, but it is not able to carry it to the tissues because of the lack of something called the petrol or the blood. So always remember, probably for the client's point of view, it is okay, you go and stuff in some 100% oxygen in the cylinder and the client sees the bubbles going and he's happy that the dog has been treated. But no, you will have to go for more than that. You have to go for a transport medium that is blood. Remember that. So the hematology parameters or the references, what we've been hearing, learning from a lot of people around the world, is amazing. And in my research, I found out that every area has its own demography, has its own way of the vector-borne diseases available there. And over a evolutionary point of time, these animals have created the reference values for themselves. So remember, it is not absolutely necessary that the hemoglobin of 14 or 20 in the US or the Europe should be the same in India. because in India, our standard conditions are different. We are tough and rough people, and we have tough and rough dogs. They have been acclimatized to this environment for a long time. And here's a small comparison. If you see the pointer, a normal hematocrit abroad in the US or Europe, you're talking about a minimum of 50 to 58. Whereas a hematocrit in our country, you're talking about 30 to 35 to 40, that's all. So the hemoglobin, which is in dogs, which is around 14 to 20 in the Western countries, you know, when we took an average of 1,000 dogs, we found that the hemoglobin was well within the reference range of 10 to 12, and not more than that, you know, the best breeds. Probably you're talking about a very lesser percentage of hounds that do have hemoglobin of more than 14. So, see the yellow thing? The yellow button says, do not panic if there is mild or moderate anemia. We have time. If there is, you know, severe anemia, then we will have to interfere. If there is mild or moderate anemia, we have a lot of chance of regeneration, and you do not transfuse according to the values. You do not treat the laboratory. You do not treat the reference values. So you treat the dog, you treat the cat, you treat clinically. For example, if someone is going to bring a dog or cat for a pre-op and the hemoglobin shows 8 to 9, well, you have time. There's nothing to be scared of, because that is how it goes. Remember, science is not maths, and our field conditions is not their field conditions. And I hope there are a lot of other people from other countries are also hearing this small presentation. So you have to go on a reference range that is viable in your place. Do not go according to the textbooks. So what are the types of anemia? Here we have a whole bunch of anemia, and I'm not going to bore you with this. More it is for a diagnostic point of view. So what is anemia? When there is a reduction in the red blood cell count, you call it as an anemia. What is thrombocytopenia? When you actually see a reduction in platelet count, you see, they mention it as thrombocytopenia. And when you see a reduction in almost all the counts, including the WBCs, RBCs, hemoglobin, hematocrit, everything, then we call it as pancytopenia. So anemia, thrombocytopenia, pancytopenia. Now in anemia, the most commonly heard term is something called IMHA. Everyone says IMHA, non-IMHA and all. So that is one of the most common anemias available and presentable in India. The second one is the non-regenerative anemia. We have something called the pure cell aplasia, that's very congenital. We have oxidant-induced hemolytic anemia, fragmentation hemolytic anemia. You can see the pointer. Iron deficiency anemia, inflammatory anemia, CKD, chronic disease anemia, endocrine disease anemia, infectious agents, drugs, hospital acquired anemia, and miscellaneous conditions. So these slides will just go on one by one on clinical diagnostics, and from there we can catch them. So what is regenerative anemia? As the term indicates, regeneration, there is going to be more of immature RBCs. For example, let us take a bleeding or a hemolysis or a destruction of RBC internally, where you see blood loss clinically. So if you take a blood work, you will see something called reticulocytosis. What is that? You're just going to see immature RBCs throughout the blood smear. That means it is more of regenerative anemia that is taking place. And you might have heard of the pathologists say macrocytic, hypochromic, that means bigger and bigger sized RBCs with lesser number of the color, that is hypochromic. And these are more indicative of regenerative anemia. So when they are presented with weakness, lethargy, pale bones, faster rate, and higher rate. So reticulocyte count is very important in the diagnosis of regenerative anemia. Normally, let us assume that the reticulocyte count is not more than 1%. if you have more than 2.5%, it indicates reticulocytosis. Now that's the pathologist's job. We don't have to worry explanation, so we give the slide to them, the whole blood to them, and they tell us whether the reticulocyte count is there or not. And very few hematology analyses. Probably you're talking about the IDEX and the Abaxis. They do give a scenario of the reticulocyte count, where not more machines do that. So next slide is the non-regenerative anemias, where you're not going to see reticulocytes. So what is that? That means the bone marrow production of blood decreases, and basically it's found in most of chronic diseases. In our field conditions, we are going to talk about a viral case or something like a vector-borne disease, like, you know, the Ehrlichia, Babesia, all CS, and they were most commonly non-regenerative. We have some cancers where there is non-regenerative. It could be a chronic abscess, it could be bleeding in the intestines, it could be Cushing's, or it could be hypothyroidism, and it could be a chronic kidney disease because of deficiency of erythropoietin. Sometimes it could be because of liver failure, and other drugs like hormone preparations of estrogen, anti-seizures, very commonly griseofalvin induced, you know, they give for months together. So these are all non-regenerative anemias. Remember, on a clinical situation, when you get a dog or a cat gasping for breath, totally blanched, anemic, going to die, it doesn't matter if it is regenerative or maybe non-regenerative. We don't have the time. So in that scenario, blood transfusion will be an emergency procedure in all type of anemias except immune-mediated anemias to counter the first step of life and death. Only when we provide blood and then we treat the case on subsequent hours, then they're going to save the case. And immune-mediated anemias, blood transfusion is contraindicated. Isn't that strange? Because when you transfuse the blood to immune-mediated diseases, they slowly start destructing again within 24 hours, 48 hours. So remember, always use high-dosed steroids or any immunosuppressants for IMHA cases, even before you start the transfusion. So now, chronic kidney disease anemia is one of the commonest available anemia amongst your practice. So they require something called erythropoiesis stimulating agents, ESA. They do not require blood. They do not require whole blood for transfusion. Remember, the case will be presented to you walking, talking and laughing, but still they will be anemic. So you can just blatantly go for erythropoietin if the owners can afford, or if you're going to redose it, you can go for a recombinant erythropoietin, something called the darbepoietin alpha. And usually erythropoietins are a loading dose of 100 U per kilo. For example, you get a 10 kilo dog, you can go up to 1000 U subcutaneous units, and you can repeat it every 2 weeks once until it attains a normal, a somewhat normal hematocrit somewhere around 30. Remember the word iron, remember iron dredge span. It has to be given at least every 2 to 3 weeks or at least 4 weeks for CKD anemia. And it can be orally given, but it's very poorly absorbed. So I normally stick on to iron dextran injections. Slightly painful, but worth it. We have preparations of iron dextran that can be used in a normal saline bottle weekly once or 2 weeks, every 2 weeks once, until they achieve a good hematocrit. So immune-mediated hemolytic anemia, I said when you do a blood smear, you might see babesiosis in dogs, you might see mycoplasma in cats, which is the most common reason for the immune mediation because of the antigen antibody effect. So on the smear, as you can see, you can see pale, smaller blood cells called spirocytes. Look at this arrow. And then to the next to that is a normal RBC, the rounded shape, where you can see a paler one that calls a spherocyte, smaller in size. So if your pathologist counts a lot of spherocytes in that film, then it is called spherocytosis. And also you can do a saline agglutination test in your clinic. All you just have, you need a microscope and 2 or 3 drops of saline. And this is more suggestive of IMHA. There's something called canine Coombs test. It's a serial dilution test. It's not that much in a lot of parts in our country. And you have an option of something called the direct antiglobulin test. That is a ready-made test available. But it does show a lot of false positive effect and false negative. So remember, IMHAs are, you know, if you don't have the funky flow cytometry machines in your practice or you cannot refer anywhere, you can go for spherocytosis and the saline agglutination test. That is more than enough to treat the steroid. So the non-regenerative anemias, as I was talking, they require something called a bone marrow aspiration cytology to find out the diagnosis of the anemia. You know, the major icon that we lack in our veterinary practice, what I have seen, including myself, it is something called a diagnostic plan on why it is happening. So we normally treat on a symptom-based issue, and the dog comes back or never comes back after transfusion, and that's it. We never have a diagnosis. When we say anemia, remember, it is just a symptom, it is not a disease. So the spelling, also, now you see the right side icon, it will say a helpful tips in a crossbar, so you make sure you note down these things. Spherocytosis, not suggestive of IMHA always. There is other possibilities of other diagnostics of spherocytosis. And in a saline agglutination test, if you see a roulet formation, you just have to disperse more of saline. If it disperses, then it is roulet formation. If it agglutinates, then it is agglutination. Normally, I go for the test tube method, which is very easy. You slant the test tube and add drops of saline to the blood. You will see agglutination in the borders. So what are the treatment plans? We are going to go for, if it's IMHA, we are going to go for any good immunosuppressants. You can go with the high dose prednisolone, stapirtof, and the cyclosporine works very good, but pretty expensive. You have to give it on an empty stomach, the dog vomits blood. So you have to make sure that you slowly, progressively increase the dose of cyclosporines on an empty stomach. And well, the very common things used in human practice also is something called prednisolone. And if the case is refractory to all this, you can go for azathioprine. Otherwise, no necessity. For IMHA, you can just simply treat with steroids. So the other type of anemia is a pure cell aplasia. When you sometimes keep consequent erythropoietin administration to an unwarranted case, then there is something called aplasia. So again, it's been rarely diagnosed in dogs. Most common other type of anemia is oxidant-induced hemolytic anemia, where ingestion of a lot of onions by dogs and cats, and ingestion of zinc by some terriers, and the ingestion of naphthalene balls, which is commonly observed, and acetaminophen, that's a paracetamol pill, they will cause anemia. On a progressive basis. So in these type of oxidant-induced hemolytic anemia, what you are going to see is something called exanthrocytes. That is, your pathologist is going to tell you again, that if that is visible in the slide, then yeah, it's an oxidant-induced hemolytic anemia. You just have to go for the antidote and treat the case. So bottom line, don't give onions to dogs. And this is the iron deficiency anemia, which I told you about. And if you look at the chart here, you will have a normal representation, which has got a storage ion, a middle representation, which is called the transport, and the erythron. So in case of iron deficiency anemia, if you look at the cursor, we might require iron, dextran, 10 mg per kilo intramuscularly, as we discussed in the last day. So your pathologist is going to say something called hypochromasia, which is very commonly observed in the cytology and smear, and that means you'll have to get ready with your IV injections. So remember, oral ferrous sulfate doesn't work that much. If you don't have an option, it can go 50 to 300 milligram every 12 hours. So blood glucose in dogs. Now, after we know the types of anemia, we have to know a basic knowledge of the available blood groups in dogs. As I am talking before you, you will be surprised that if I ask you how many blood groups are there in human beings, you are going to say 4, A, B and O. So what I am saying is there is more than 38 to 40 blood groups that are available in the human practice, out of which the AB group is more important because they kind of agglutinate and they cause death. Likewise, dogs have a lot of blood groups, trust me, more than 11, 13, even every year they are actually finding one more blood group, of which our specific enemy will be the highly antigenic DEA1.1, because this fellow can cause hemolytic reactions and death on repeated transfusions. So apart from the 1.2, 3, 4, 5, 7, in our practice, if we group a dog that is DEA 1.1 positive or DEA 1.1 negative, that is more than enough. We don't have to worry for all this. And remember, a dog can have several blood groups. So our aim will be to type a positive dog or type a negative dog. That's it, finished. And this is one of the Chippy Parais in our, it's a hound in Tamil Nadu. So that is being checked as a good, healthy, viable donor in our part of the state. And as I told you about the other antigens, for research work, 1.2, DEA4, and that is very important. 7 is important, but for clinical practice, that is not important. So we can skip this slide. In cats, they have 3 blood groups. One is A, A is very common, B supposedly rare, and AB, which is extremely rare. So there are only 3 blood groups in cats. Now, they have a very simple max, because you know that cats are not from our planet, they are from somewhere else. And a cat A can give to cat A, a cat A can give to cat AB, likewise AB. A cat B can give to cat B. Simple rules. If a cat A gives to cat B, you're going to see death in 30 seconds flat. So be very careful in transfusing cats. You have to have blood type in kits and plus the cross match before you transfuse a cat. So, useful tips. There's something called xenotransfusion for an emergency basis at a life-threatening situation. A dog can donate blood to a cat. The cat is not going to die. You can just bravely go ahead. Per year, we averagely do around 13 to 14 transfusions from a dog to cat. But make sure the dog is, you know, free from all infectious and diseases. And make sure that you inform the owners well ahead that this is going to be an emergency situation. And this blood lives in the cat for not more than 4 to 6 days. So you can buy time, that's it. But it works good. Because cat donors and cat blood is not quite commonly available. So this is an alternative. Should I worry about blood groups on a field level for a first transmission? In dogs, no. Because that is why you and me have been escaping a lot of dog deaths even after the first transmission without a typing. So they do not require a typing. Dogs do not require a typing on the first transmission. But for subsequent transfusions, yes, they require. Whereas cats do require typing on first transfusion. So remember that. Now, what are the indications for transfusions in dogs? So whenever you get an anemic dog, whenever you get severe blood loss or any IMHAs, when the dog is full of ticks and blood loss, when you have a case for a surgery, you can keep blood from a healthy dog. Post-surgery, you can transfuse, or some of the cases where a huge mass is removed, most common in the spleen. So we do something called auto transfusion, where we collect blood from the dog 2 or 3 days prior to the surgery and bank it for till 10 days, and then they can give it to the same dog. That's called auto transfusion after the surgical part. So another common diseases in blood for indications will be something called leptospirosis and sepsis. So we have to be very careful in evaluating sepsis, but they do have something called SARS related anemia. And the most common problems in puppies are hookworms, where there are a lot of cases that require whole blood. They are usually presented with pot belly. We'll see on the on the next videos. So when there is something called hemochromatosis disease and more of ecchymosis involved, less of thrombocytes, we have something called DIC in sepsis. Any bleeding disorders for an emergency, we can go for a whole blood transfusion, not an issue. So when you are going to be presented with a case that has got a lot of dots, as you call, by the owners, and suddenly they emerge overnight, what are you going to do? So you are going to check out whether this is allergy, or you are going to see whether this is not allergy. So this is a simple test where you're going to have the so-called expensive glass light, and you're going to press it on the skin. You can see that when you press it, it does not blanch. It stays like that, like a statue. So if it stays like that, then it is called, if it stays like that, it's called bleeds. If it is an allergy, it is going to get blanched. You will not see anything post the slide. So in a bleeding, in a bleeding case or ecchymosis, the dots are going to be there. So this is a differential between a tricharia and ecchymosis, and this procedure is called dioscopy. So you are going to see the next case where the indications of transfusions is a puppy. Looks like a German Shepherd with a iatric anemic mucous membrane. It is kind of having respiratory distress, lateral recumbency, and what is the color of the mucous membrane? It is more of iatric blanched mucous membrane. So you can see the pot belly here, probably because of hyperproteinemia, or probably because of the ascitic fluid involved. But what you have to notice is whenever you see a dog with icterus and anemia, you think of hemolysis, as simple as that. So this is the case that requires a blood transfusion without an issue.
Sir, can you be a little louder? Like some people are not able to hear things properly.
Yes.
Please, sir.
Should I increase the volume?
Volume, or like you can be near to the laptop, that will be.
Okay.
Yeah. Shall I
increase the volume and see?
Yeah, this is fair, sir. No problems.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
And the other transmission indications will be something called centesis. When you normally do thoracocentesis in your practice, you have to make sure that you have some whole blood or packed RBCs nearby, because the most common sign of clinical signs of anemia happen 24 hours after centesis. So this is one of the puppies that has been thoracocentesized, and if you can see the fluid, it is more blood tint. So the blood tint fluid varies accordingly. It is very case dependent. For example, this case, she seems to have a lot of blood and fibrin clots when a centesis is made. And look at that. Whenever you see more of blood or fibrin, you always think about a tumor that is sitting down somewhere, or you can always think about a hemoprotism that can outwardly cause lysis in the abdomen cavity. Now, in cats, Mycoplasma pilis is one of the most important hemoprotozoan that is underestimated one and responds beautifully to enrofloxacin or doxycycline. The cats don't tolerate doxy fine, but you can go ahead with enrofloxacin. So this is a cat which is having Mycoplasma hemophilus, and look at the respiration that is having. You have to differentiate between an effusion and the anemia involved here. So normally the cat is not like a dog, so they don't gasp much like oral breathing, but they kind of keep very calm, and you can see the abdominal type of breathing, the thorax being steady and mild oral breathing here. So remember, blood transfusion is not a cure. You have a tank that's been leaking and you have to fix the tank. You cannot transfuse and make the dog all right. So you have to refill the tank till it goes to the proper next petrol pump. Before that, you need to diagnose and treat the case. We don't have much of time. You're talking about 1-2 days after the transfusion. You need to diagnose and then you have to treat the case. So also remember that all the mucous membranes which are pale or not anemic, most commonly the blanched mucous membrane can be something because of poor perfusion. If you give hydration with a colloid or a crystalloid, normal saline ringostatic, after a couple of minutes you can see the mucous membrane getting pink in color. So remember, it could be because of poor perfusion also. So always go for the hematology before you transfuse. So what do I require to do a transfusion? What are the materials and methods? Well, I guess most of this we have. So to top it all, we should have the glass slides, cotton gauze, spirit, a working microscope, working stethoscope. You must have a tabletop centrifuge. Good hair clippers, you can get the portable ones. You can have something called the hemoglobinometer, that is a handheld version. You should have test tubes, blood bags, transfusion sets, and blood typing kits. Now, these are the minimal equipments. So I think most of them are already available in the clinic, just to refresh you. So these are the handheld hemoglobinometers available in the market. So we have the good ones called HemaQ. That's been standardized for long years, and I've been using it for 10 years. You can buy them for approximately 25 to 30,000. And we have the latest ones called Fresenius Kebbi. They are too good, excellent, I've used them. And they also cost the same. If you want to go for a lower budget, you can go for some of the hemocytometers that cost around 5,000 to 6,000 rupees. And each the test kit will cost you somewhere around 25 to 35 rupees, that's all. So you have to invest in a hemoglobinometer, because you cannot wait for the blood to be sent to the lab and then blah, blah, blah. Instead of that, you can just do probably in 2 or 3 minutes in a clinical setup. It's very easy. You have to have a centrifuge. A basic centrifuge will cost you somewhere around 20 to 25,000. You will have to invest in that. You have no shortcuts. You have to get good, clear vacutainer tubes of EDTA and non-EDTA. Clippers, yes, we have those. And these are other clippers that cost you some 25,000. You have other basic models of rechargeable. I normally go for the rechargeable clipper. It's very useful. And recently, other products are also available within 5,000 to 6,000 rupees. They are not very good. And for whole blood banking, that is a simple whole blood banking instruments, what you need is a blood collection monitor. That is the first one. A sealer that works on radio RF and sealing. It can seal the blood bag without RBC lysis. You need a hand stripper to strip the contents from the tubes and the bubbles and the clots. And you need to have a blood bag refrigerator. Now remember, before even I could open this subject, if you need to buy everything of this, you should have a proper blood bank license. So it's still under controversy. But as a single unit in the clinic, a basic refrigerator will be more than enough. Instead of a blood touch and monitor, you can ask some people to sit and collect the whole blood. And the component banking instruments will involve something called the blood bag centrifuge. It's a huge machine, and there are desktop versions available. You would have a sealer, you would have something called a plasma expressor that expresses the plasma, and you need a platelet agitator that agitates platelets for 5 to 7 days. You need plasma freezers and a refrigerator. So again, blood banking needs license, so it is definitely illegal to maintain a blood bank without licensing. It's a hard way to go, because for veterinary use, there is no specified legal requirements on according to drugs and cosmetic acts. We have an issue on that. So be careful when you ship these instruments. So this is mandated according to the CDSCO, and unfortunately, there's no provision for a veterinary blood bank. So what are we going to do? Well, we can just go for a normal blood bag and a transfusion set that is more than enough for a practice for a whole blood transfusion. Now, the blood bags are of different kinds. You might have a 350 ml of blood bag. You might have seen them. That has 49 ml of CPTA. That is more than enough for a whole blood transfusions. And if you need to go for component therapy, you need to have the component blood bags. So we have available cat blood bags abroad in the Europe and the US, but we don't have it here. You can always modify a pediatric blood bag. All you need is a 50 ml syringe or 30 ml syringe. If you're going to collect 30 ml of blood from a cat weighing 5 kilos, you need a blood bag and a CPTA so that you can store the blood for a minimum of 28 days. So blood typing kits, I think it's now available in your state, and a lot of people are selling this. We have 2-3 companies that deal with it, and basically they work on an immunochromatographic assay. So the results are going to be like this. If you see a single band, it is negative for DEA1. If you see double band strong, it is positive for DEA1. So we have blood typing kits for dog erythrocytic 1. That will be very useful for you. Each typing case will cost you around somewhere around 1,400 to 1,800 rupees landing price. It's very expensive for one test. Again, we don't have an alternative. Likewise, we have blood typing kits available for cats also. So what do we need for a private practice? We need fresh whole blood that is very, very simple. You don't have to maintain a donor. So what you need to do is you will have to have a database of your existing client-based dogs. You can type them when they come for a vaccination, or you can type them when they are okay with transfusion. So you have a set of DEA negative dogs and DEA positive dogs database so that you can call them for an emergency, and you can offer them freebies and the blood donor incentives so that they are also more than the first time they will come again and again for blood donations. Likewise, you can have database of the blood type A, blood type B cats. So the donor group, pooling all these non-vet people, getting NGOs into action, it is more of extension job. So what I would suggest the private practice associations, they can actually form the network within their groups, WhatsApp groups. So you can share the database of the dogs which have negative and positive blood so that it's equally divided amongst your people. So anyone who wants to call the dog can call, and the owners can come happily to donate blood. That's the easiest way, instead of maintaining a blood bank or maintaining a donor level. So what are the injections and material for drugs that you need beforehand for transfusion? you will have to have antihistamine, that is the CPM. You have to have immunosuppressants like prednisolone. You should have adrenaline to counter post-translation anaphylaxis. You should have diuretics like furosemide. You should have heparin. You can have diazepam, ketamine, butorphanol before you even start transfusion. So, the module which is going to tell us when to transfuse blood is which is majorly depending on the presentation of the case. For example, this pug which is presented, it's almost in a sternal recumbency, and it is a grasping for breath. It's a young dog. It is having hypoxia and it is having dyspnea. It's peeing without knowledge. The mentation is altered. If you actually auscultate, you will find something called the anemic murmurs, and you will find a thready pulse, and you will also find the aortic thudding at the level of abdomen. Remember, if you keep the stethoscope near the location of the kidneys, you will hear sounds of thudding. That means the patient is ready for transfusion, hemoglobin below 3. So again, these are cats showing respiratory distress. Remember, cats are more calm, they don't have more oral breathing. They just lie quiet and start slowly breathing heavily. So you should watch out some mucous membranes. When they have dyspnea, you'll have to differentiate the effusion and an anemic crisis. So yes, now we have paler dyspnea, polypnea. Then you take blood and you see the hemoglobin is less than 4 in dogs, you can go for transfusion. You see a hemoglobin less than 3 in dogs, 3 in cats, you can go ahead with transfusion. But remember, clinically, these animals should have respiratory distress, breathing difficulty, something called hypoxia, to even carry out a transfusion. That means you have the time. But these emergency cases, you will have to go for transfusion. That's the decision making. And this is one of the dog puppies, looks like probable poop-borne manifestation. So if you carefully see the mucous membranes, they are paper white, and their mentation is very altered. They are not able to breathe much, and they are in a recumbent state. So you can go ahead with the transfusion for these cases. And older dogs, when they are presented with anemia, they have more of a respiratory distress compromise. It could be a tumor sitting inside the spleen, it could be a cardiac issue. But once you see the mucous membranes of the dogs, they kind of get like a pain. And in some cases, you can see the jugular pulse extended, and you can see the dogs exhibiting a sign called orthopnea, that is, they will acclaim positions to breathe easily, otherwise they die. So if you put them on lateral recumbency immediately for an x-ray or any procedure, you are going to lose the case. Remember, for anemic dogs, do not put them on a lateral recumbency. Whatever shape they are coming in, you can just go ahead. And other major causes of anemia include sepsis, where I guess this is one case of pyometritis where the dog is anemic and needs blood. So remember, anemia is in different forms, so you have to be careful about the differentials involved. So how do I go for a donor dog? So it's very simple. The donor dog should be fit and healthy, friendly, vaccinated, and deworm. Basically, before 1 year and 8 years of age, that's more than enough. It should be vaccinated, and it should be negative for all sort of hemoglobin infections. And if it is possible, it should be a negative blood group so as to it can donate to any dog that is in distress. So this will be a 1 minute examination of how to find out whether the donor is actually healthy. So see, this is a Rajapalayam breed, a hound of our native state. It is having very pink mucous membranes. I am examining the lymph nodes, which is normal, the prescapular lymph nodes, and basically the spleen, which I palpate during every case. If you see a splenomegaly, never take up this case. the lymph nodes, if it's swollen, it's not a very good donor. So the healthy dog should be presented and clinically examined before a donation, and this is the ideal donor. Cats, yes, they must be within a minimum of 4 to 5 kilos. They should not have any cardiac murmur. They should be fully vaccinated, preferably indoors, deworm, and if possible, screen for hemoprotozoan parasites. And basically, they should have a PCV of at least 30 to 40. Weight should be 4 to 5 kilos, PCV should be 40. And the cat should be very calm. If you have aggressive cats, very difficult to collect blood, you might have to sedate them. And once you have the donors, you have something called the blood cross matching. That is the basic cross matching between the donor and the recipient. As we know, that everybody knows about cross matching, but only thing, it's like an ECG, it is very confusing. So the simplest way is, as you can see in this picture, a major cross matching will require donor RBC and patient serum. That is a minor cross matching on the reverse. So all you have to do is collect the donor serum here and the recipient RBCs and put on incubation after 3 washes, and then centrifuge them again, then take them out and remove the buttons and see whether they are agglutinating or not agglutinating. So macroscopically you can see in test tube, or microscopically you can see in glass slide. So this is a quicker approach of putting the packed RBCs of 0.2 ml and 4.8 saline, so that you can wash the 3-stage washing. So if you have a pathologist nearby, you can definitely give the samples for cross matching. A proper cross matching will take a minimum of 1 to 1.5 hours, because it has to be incubated. So blood collection procedures, I think everybody will know this, but just to refresh you, jugular collections and jugular phlebotomies are the best options for dogs. You'll have to have some persons to help you, assist you. You'll have to have a person to hold the dog. And if possible, you can invest in the blood collection monitor. You don't have to have one person moving the blood bag. So a blood collection monitor costs around 50,000 rupees to 75 to 1 lakh. It is very useful in routine practice if you're doing a lot of cases. So the jugulars are the veins that has to be raised from the external mandible. So remember, when you are going for jugular collection, you need the height of the dog and you need someone holding the blood bag. The phlebotomized person should hold the jugular phlebotomy correctly so that the dog does not move much. So make sure that it's done in a very calm environment, and rocking the bag for at least 15 minutes will collect 350 ml of blood without a problem. So this is one of the small collection procedures where the jugular phlebotomy is done. And I usually put a small knot here. Emergency, you have the time to actually take out the blood bag or to strip it out, because sometimes the dog might shake the head, or it might turn violent. Sometimes the person who is handling might not hold properly. So make sure that you form a small knot so that it's easy for your own collection. And how many people are required? You're talking about a minimum of 4 people is definitely necessary for a collection. And so you can see here, one person is holding the head and 2 persons on that. And if you can actually see this person behind, he fell down and he is rest on the table, because I told him to lay down quiet, because he's got something called the syncope, which is very common in clients. So make sure that you ask the persons whether they are scared of blood or no, before even to try heroically collecting blood. Otherwise, you're going to waste a lot of time. So if it is going to be a vicious cat, yes, you have to sedate the cats, and if you have a vicious dog, you will have to sedate the dog. Remember, if you have an eligible donor, you try as much as to collect blood and never send them back, because if you send them back, they are not going to come back again. And remember, the Labradors and obese dogs are not good donors. And they are obese and they have a thick adipose tissue. And it's going to be very difficult for you or me. If you have a cat blood donation, never bring in the owners. You can ask them to sit down quietly in the reception while you meddle with the cat here. So some of the cases where improper phlebotomy is done, where if you multiply start pricking the jugular veins, you might cause injuries like this. As you can see, all the edemas from here to here are because of previous venipuncture. And think that it's your dog and do not do most of the punctures. You just go one by one. Never give xylazine as a sedation, because it will cause depression and it will take a lot of time for you to collect blood. In case you give, back up with normal saline or Ringer's factor soon after the transfusion and the collection. So this is how the blood transfusion sets are there. They have a proper filter when compared to the other blood transfusion, other normal sets, IV sets. So you will have a spike and a place to open this on. So there are a lot of companies which deal with this, which are very equivalently competitive. And they cost around 100 to 150 rupees. And so once you open it, you have to hold the, you take out the tubings. And this is a curved spike, what you can see here, the green portion. And it's got a filter, the white portion. So the blood bags have basically one and two kind of knobs there. So they are easily tearable. You just hold it, tear it apart. Yeah. So, and you slant a bit. You have to slant a bit because it's curved. And you'll have to slowly screw it up. Do not poke it. If you poke it, your blood bag gets punctured. It's blood all over. So be very careful. And you can leave the air bubbles off, and this you know how to do. So the most important step of this is how you connect the blood bag, because you have to be very careful not spilling the blood. Now, the canine whole blood transfusion has CPD. So remember, if you can store the whole blood at 1 to 6 degrees. Normally the refrigerator, the topmost portion will have 4 to 5 degrees of the temperature. So if you want to hold them there, you can go ahead for a minimum of 28 days. And if it is going to be outside, it should be not more than 4 hours. So the storage room temperature for blood, not more than 4 hours. And the platelets are viable only for 6 hours after collection. So now the blood transfusion, again, it's good. If you go to transfuse an anemic dog, it's better you find the peripheral veins and axis here, as what you can see. It's a cannula fitted here for the blood to go. If it is very difficult on that, you can go for a jugular vein axis, because sometimes when your patients, you cannot access the veins, then it will be very difficult to give blood. Now, what are the packed RBCs? Now, packed RBCs are nothing but the red blood cells separated from the plasma, and they are devoid of plasma and WBC. So you will not have a reaction from the first or second transfusion. And this has got a centrifugation protocol on the blood bank. So most commonly we use packed RBCs for renal failure cases, so that much of plasma and reactions are not involved. Platelets. Well, we've been hearing of platelets. They're viable for a maximum of 5 to 6 days only. And after the collection, the platelets are being stored in an agitator, which incubates platelets for 5 days. So they have a gentle agitation, only then they are viable. And if you prepare platelets separately, you can harvest via a spin centrifugation process of the fresh whole blood, and you can get up to 8 in 10 to the power of 10 platelets per unit. If you have 70 to 80 ml of platelets as one unit, you can transfuse it to a dog weighing 10 to 15 kilos. So it is very useful in thrombocytopenia cases and nasal bleeding cases. So this is one more dog. It's got less of thrombocytes, somewhere around 15,000 cells. And you can see the profuse bleeding bilaterally. Very common in summer seasons, very common in retroborn diseases. So after platelets therapy, there seems to be a lot of improvement. And you can see immediately within a couple of, 20-30 minutes, you can see that the bleeding is stopped and an emergency. Now, question is, what if you don't have platelets? Yeah, you can go ahead with sedation. I'll tell you in the next slides how to go ahead. So again, this is one more dog which is having nasal bleeding, but these dogs seem to be very, they are not anoxic or hypoxic. They are stable. Only thing is nasal bleeding case are stable, but they keep on bleeding. So this is the dog after the platelet administration. It takes a half an hour to 1 hour and to arrest the bleeds. So if you want to think about management of epistaxis, you'll have to learn what not to use. What not to use? Ice cubes, ice packs, the nasal tamponade sponges, tranexamic acid, botropas, which you commonly use. For my experience, I have not found much of improvement in these structures. That if you try using something called vincristine on a TVD dose, 0.01 milligram IV, or a prednisolone as an immunosuppressant, or diazepam to bring down the dog's excitement, it works better. So left side things doesn't work better, right hand side things works good. And the other component we're going to discuss is the fresh frozen plasma. They have their own centrifugation protocols in the blood banking system. Basically, they have coagulation factors. We're talking about factor 5, 3, factor 2. And they can be used, stored up to 1 year at 18 degrees centigrade. So most common indications of FFP is DIC, it is liver failure. You're talking about deficiency of clotting factors, rodenticide toxicity. So it will be very useful for fresh frozen plasma to be administered. And one of the most common things is, paroviral infections, where you can supplement with growth proteins. So the packed RBCs we have already seen. It is most commonly used to avoid risk of fluid overload for any compromised patients. And it avoids the potential risk of immunological reactions for the plasma. So cryoprecipitate, this is one of the, byproducts of the blood banking procedures. So now we have cryoprecipitate is very rich in fibrinogen. So most commonly for nasal epistaxis bleeding, dogs which lack BW1 Willebrand and some cases that we require cryoprecipitate are mostly, these fancy imported breeds that are presented with factor deficiencies. So what is the rate of infusion for most common thumb rule for blood and blood components? So if you're going to infuse blood, you can never infuse any other IV medications. So remember, the initial rate of transfusion will be just 1 to 2 ml per kilo per hour for the first 30 minutes. Within these 30 minutes, if you're actually going to see any reactions, then you might have to cut off the transfusions immediately or the blood typing and the cross-reaction. If you see a reaction, stop the transfusion, that's all. Obtain a temperature pulse respiration every 15 minutes. Monitor basic vital signs. If you see hives, drop in blood pressure, facial swelling, degenerative edema, vomiting, you have to stop transfusion. So normally what I do is after a couple of 20 to 30 minutes, I increase the volume of transfusion depending upon the patient's sterility. And I finish off the transfusion within 3 hours to maximum 4 hours because you are inviting a contamination over a long time storage. I have seen people transfusing from morning to evening, absolutely not safe. Just back off everything within 3.5 hours, that's more than enough. Now, after the transfusion is finished, we have to flush the remaining blood product in the extension cells with IV line. You can save some blood cells. So, what are the practical tips? The calculated dose should be finished within 3 hours of transfusion. If you are saying that the patient is hypovolemic and might tolerate over 2 hours, you can extend more. So the bags cannot be kept in room temperature for more than 4 hours. So the dose for whole blood transfusion, we have a calculation that is based on the body weight into a constant 90 for dogs and 60 for cats into desired PCV minus recipient PCV divided by the donor PCV. Now, if you think that this max is really confusing, you can go for a simple thumb rule, like 2 ml of whole blood will raise the PCV by 1 percentage point or the hemoglobin by 0.3 grams. Now, as a thumb rule, you will have to assume that your recipient needs a packed cell volume of 30, not more than that. If your recipient is presented with a packed cell volume of 10 or 8 or 11, you'll have to make sure that the packed cell volume should be increased to 25 to 30 and not to 40 or 50. You just have to increase the packed cell volume to 25 to 30 of the recipient. So that should be an aim, that should be the calculation. So what do you do for cats? Again, it's the same, but the constant is 60 into body weight into desired PCV minus the recipient PCV. Again, a volume of whole blood of 2 ml will raise the PCV by 1%. You have to have a transfusion monitoring chart, a handwritten one, where you can see the TPR, temperature, pulse quality, the CRT, if you have a BP instrument, the blood pressure, whether it is having any other rigors, dyspnea, any vomiting, most common diarrhea, every 15 minutes for a minimum of 2 hours. So this monitoring chart will be very helpful in assessing whether the dog is actually going in for acute hemolytic reaction or no. And do not give blood with any other fluids, that is very important. And the blood transfusion reactions in this slide will tell us about immune mediated reactions, and that is acute. One is hemolytic transfusion reactions, trichuria, edema, and non-immune mediated reactions like sepsis, circulatory overload. Again, one of the most important points to catch in veterinary practice, like if you start giving a dog more blood than what is warranted, it will cause something called circulatory overload, which will lead to transfusion associated lung injury. So the delayed reactions will have more of immune mediated reactions. That will happen after the 1 or 2 weeks after the transfusion. So mostly presented dogs after the blood transfusion, they kind of start vomiting very badly, and most of the common symptoms what I have seen is diarrhea. The other signs are here, facial swelling, and this is called angiogenic edema. Normally if you give adrenaline or more commonly a corticosteroid with an Avil or CPM, that is more than enough to counter the dog. So in my experience, I have seen most common symptoms are of the transfusion reactions are vomiting and diarrhea. So in acute reactions, they have hives and trichuria. And remember, dogs are stable even after a reaction, but cats, they die immediately during a mismatch transfusion. So general precautions and warnings of blood transfusion. If you handle improperly aseptically, you can invite something called a non-immunologic reactions. So you have to be very careful in that. So what are the methods where we can minimize that? We have to pre-warm blood. You have to make sure that it is a continuous slow rate of infusion. Use a transfusion set. Maintain sterile techniques, or at least a minimum of surgical spirit and alcohol-based sterilizers for all the drilling catheters, and your hands and wear gloves, use proper underpants and all. And administer appropriate doses based on the body weight and the breed. So what are the things not to do? As I was talking to you about the transmission associated circulatory overload. So the volume of the blood cannot be more than 20%, 20 mmHg per kilo of the body weight of the recipient. So that's a thumb rule. I'll repeat, the whole blood volume should not be more than 20 ml per kilo weight of the recipient. You can stick on to the calculation part of it and do not use any hypotonic solutions, for example, dextrose or calcium containing RL. Please do not use it during the transfusion. The best compatible solution, as everyone knows, is saline with the red blood cell spots. So we have crossed 6:15. I know it's kind of long and slightly boring lecture. Any discussions and chats and any
sir, it was a really great lecture, sir. Not at all boring. Like, like there have been a lot of questions been asked by the participants in the question section, sir.
Okay. Okay.
So what we can do is like we can stop the streaming right now, this screen, sir, and we can go to the question section.
Yes. Should I close this one or?
Yeah. We can close this.
Madhavan,
done, sir. Yeah. So, so thank you so much for this good, insightful presentation. And like, hope everybody must have loved it. So, considering like the interest of people, they have a lot of questions thrown. Like many multiple questions, you can see. So we'll start with the first question. So, like, what entire people are interested with. So, like. The first question was been asked regarding, I'll just tell you, like, if collecting bag not available for blood donor, things are getting refreshed.
Yeah. Can you repeat the question?
Just a minute, sir. That is getting refreshed. I'm just.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
So they are asking if there is no collecting bag, so how can they do it in the field condition?
See, that is what Dr. Reddy, now we are in 2020. We cannot tell the same thing again and again.
No.
Okay, they have been hearing this 10 years back down the line. So we as associations, no, it's very relevant because they need something for transmission, right? So I guess association should take this up and pull in blood bags for a private practice. That is very, very important. Now, if you don't have a blood bag, yeah, like the olden days, you can take a 50 ml or 100 ml syringe, or 50 ml syringe, you can get heparin and you can dilute, you start mixing blood and keep 4 or 5 syringes for an emergency transmission, not an issue. But we need to get the blood bags to keep the next thing going.
Okay, sir. Next question.
So I hope like the participant must have got the answer. Sir, the next question, like they have asked.
I can see that on the chat, correct, Dr.
Chat, in the chat, next to the chat, there's a question section, sir.
Shall I press on that?
Next to that, there's question.
You can click on that, sir.
Oh. Yes. Yeah, it's refreshing.
So meanwhile, is it the same blood bag for both cats and dogs?
Actually speaking, we have a smaller versions for the cats. But in India, we don't have it, so we can use the pediatric version. The neonatal blood bags are available. Again, that you cannot just get it. That you can use it as an alternative for cats. So we can go with Santosh Gaikwad, correct? Or it's still refreshing?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. It says loading questions.
I have a question, sir.
Yes, sir.
So The recipient is obviously anemic and it may not be very aggressive at the time of receiving the blood. But donor, many times it's difficult to find the donor immediately at the time of requirement. So if the dog, the donor seems to be very, very aggressive, not cooperative, and if we are really at risk to collect the blood from the jugular lobotomy, what kind of sedations can we, use the sedative or not? If at all so, which sedative would be more safer?
So what textbook says is do not use xylazine because it is it depresses the blood pressure and all. But for example, we get a German Shepherd which is totally aggressive, then xylazine is a magic. But remember the dosage. You will have to go half of the dose, and I normally give an IV dose along with atropine, and it causes beautiful sedation. If you have access to aspromazine, that is one of the drugs qualified for before a pre-medical, or you can go for diazepam, slow IV. You have to be very careful because some dogs get agitated on diazepam. Or you can go for butrophenol. So it is up to your choice. But you can go ahead
and butrophenol are better. Okay.
Yes, better. You can substitute the volume of.
Is it at a regular dose or half of the dose, sir?
Not a regular dose at all. Xylazine, you'll have to go for half of the dose.
Just 0.5.
0.5 milligram, perfect. And butrophenol, you can go for the original dose, that's not an issue. You'll also have to replace the volume what you've taken with the normal saline fluid, IV fluid, after the sedative. So it keeps on loading, shall I, or you can ask questions, Dr. Prakash. Okay. Dr. Prakash, you'll have to unmute.
Yeah, I will. Yes.
1 minute. Shall I unmute for you?
We are doing, sir. Prakash, yours is muted. So, meanwhile, the question asked is how to store the blood? How to store the blood in normal hospital conditions?
See, if you don't have a blood bank refrigerator, you can store it in your normal fridge. Only thing is, if you're collecting whole blood, you will have to make sure that you keep it on the topmost part of the fridge, because the bottommost part of the fridge will have more than 6-7 degrees. So the topmost part below the freezer will have 4-5 degrees. You can store the blood. Every day you will have to agitate it and keep it back again for a minimum of 28 days.
Okay. We can store
if you collect some 5 bags, you can happily keep it in your one part of the shelf, provided it should be an inverter fridge connected to a power source. There should be no power interruption. If there is power interruption, you wouldn't know the next day and the blood becomes stale.
So maximum of how many days, sir?
You can go up to 28 days.
28 days. Okay, sir.
Okay, sir.
So when we are collecting around 250 to 300 ml of blood, so what should the weight of a donor?
A donor should be a minimum of 22 kilos. If you want to collect 350 ml.
Yes, Prakash, please go ahead with the questions.
Yes, sir. So the next question was regarding how many times can blood transfusion be carried out in a dog or cats in entire life?
Like in human beings, a lot of patients carry out every month, so there is no ceiling limit for that.
Mm-hmm.
If you actually have a correct proportional donor, for example, you have a type negative donor for the same recipient, you can do multiple transfusions, not an issue. So, you know, the highest transfusions for one dog that is still alive in my practice, it's got kidney issues. It's a beagle. I have done so far around 14 transfusions.
Oh, that's great. So, the number of transfusions is not a big issue. Yes, sir.
multiple transmissions, multiple correct transmissions will not cause any harm. In fact, in human beings, if you see, if, for example, if you are going to get operated, if you require four units will be from different donors.
Okay.
And so they are tested to be compatible, not an issue.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Can I go into the answers? I can read it on.
Yeah, sir. You can go.
Yes, sir. You can go ahead, sir. No problem.
So Srikant, Bangalore. Huh?
So yes, sir.
Srikant has asked, what is the maximum blood a dog can donate? So if you're talking about a Labrador or German Shepherd, a medium-sized dog from 20 to 25 kilos, you can take 350 mls of blood. For Great Danes, you can definitely take 2 bags, no harm. So it will be proportional to the weight.
Great. Thank you, sir. So the next one?
And Tusra Ranjit.
Yeah. So what is the maximum blood a dog can donate the same, sir? Then what, like, sir, major and minor matching, not able to write the question properly, sir, there.
Yeah, I can read it. So Narendran Raghavendran has said,
PPK question, sir, that's
a question. Major and minor, probably saying me to explain major and minor matching again.
Yes,
put again. Yes. Can I put it again?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. So this will be a simplified version of the major and minor cross match. Remember, I told you, cross matching is like ECG. Everybody gets confused. So remember, basically, a major cross match is between the donor RBC and the recipient serum. Minor is just the opposite. So the major is very important in veterinary practice, and the minor is also important. So what you will have to do is, basically, you will have to centrifuge in a EDTA tubes both the donor and the recipient's blood. Once you centrifuge the blood, you will get serum and the RBC. So you have to mark in all the test tubes donor serum, donor RBC, recipient serum, recipient RBC. Now you will have 4 test tubes. Now the donor serum and the recipient RBCs are going to be mixed. But point is, recipient RBCs are very thick. You cannot mix just like that. We need to wash it and dilute it. So what we are going to do is, we can take, see this slide, from the recipient of blood, we can take 0.2 ml and put it in 4.8 ml of NS. So it totally becomes 5 ml. It appears like a weakened tomato juice. So that is eligible for, it's called a washed RBC. So now you put the serum and you put the RBC and you incubate in a incubator for 37 degrees centigrade. If you don't have an incubator, you can just keep it at room temperature, no harm, because our room temperatures are the same, for a minimum of 1 hour. Then take it out, you will have to centrifuge. Once you centrifuge, you will find a small button here on the down pane. You will have to agitate it and see whether you can see clumped RBCs or no clumped RBCs. And I have explained this very poorly. If you want to, you can watch YouTube videos on how practically it is done, and it's very easy.
Thank you, sir.
How frequent can we collect blood from the same donor, Sri Soumya? Dr. Soumya, you can technically collect blood every 21 days to 30 days from a donor. But non-technically, we would average around every 3 months once per year. If you can collect 4 times, it's good for the dog. So the next question is, if the donor has an allergic issue, will that get transmitted to the recipient blood on transfusion? If you're talking about skin, the allergic issue, yeah, if it's atopy, there is a possibility. So you will have to have a healthy, clean donor without allergy issue, without malassezia, without scabies, without demodex. That is always better. So Dr. Divya, she says after the first transfusion is done, how many days can we again transfuse blood? Yeah, that's a good question, Dr. Divya. If it is immune mediated anemia, we do it the next day also. We have no options. So, but generally, if you tackle the primary issue correctly, you can wait for a week. So it is again no hard and fast rule. So I think everybody in Karnataka is doing transfusions. That is why they have so many doubts. And this is the second stage of what they are learning. So you have to pick up multiple transfusions. Only then you do better. So Yatish Chandrasekhar has said age limit for transfusions. Like donor's body weight has limited.
Has limit. Is donor body weight having any
limits? The donations, the donors should be a minimum of 1 year to 8 years old. They cannot be very young, they cannot be very old. What is the ratio of blood to CPDA? If you're averagely calculated blood bag which is having 350 ml of blood, 50 ml will be the CPDA. So you can calculate that.
Fair enough. So next,
so I'll repeat that, for 350 ml blood, you need approximately 50 ml of CPDA. Please share any brand or company which can provide the blood bag. So I told you getting blood bag is off the shelf, it's not legal, so I cannot present any phone numbers here. We can spread the word through association. So probably blood kits or any other things, I can suggest you numbers.
Okay, sir.
You can share, sir.
For blood kits, sir. For blood kits.
Share, yeah, I think one Biogal Rajendran, he is doing one. I think he is doing the hematology analysis. He's got access to blood kits. So are you visualizing the slide now?
No, sir.
No, sir.
No,
sir. No? No, sir. You'll have to share it again, sir.
Oh, you'll have to share it again. Or please share. Okay, can I answer this or?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, can answer.
But if I click it, nothing is coming.
Just share the numbers, the phone numbers, sir.
Okay.
Sir, on email we can share later on, sir. Not a problem, sir.
So we'll finish off. You can take down this number.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay. It's 98190.
Okay, sir.
Yes, sir.
98676. So I'll repeat, one Mr. Rajendra, he is dealing with the hematology analysis and blah blah. He is importing from Europe. So 98190, 98676.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir.
I posted the answer also, sir.
And the other person who can also support is one Satish.
Okay, sir.
His number is 938000.
938000.
1310.
310. Okay, sir.
Yes, so I answered Satpal Pai. Now, Selvi Dharmalingam doctor, can you update the use of intravenous iron sucrose? Okay. So I have to share the slides again, or I can just answer.
Yeah, you have to share, sir. We cannot see, sir.
Okay, basically you're looking at 50 milligram of iron that comes in a 5 ml ampule. So for a 10 kilo dog, you can take 5 ml, and I basically put it in 500 ml of normal saline. So that is the best thing to do instead of a IM injection. So it is basically human preparation, so that can be used IV. So the next question will be Tusar Jain. doctor is asking, what is the maximum amount of blood we can collect from a healthy dog? What is the maximum can be infused with a recipient dog? So maximum amount from 22 kilos is 350 ml, and you cannot infuse maximum blood to a recipient. Remember, your target should be a 25 to 30 pack PCV, not more than that. You have to help the dog in survival. You cannot replace the entire deficit. Remember that. How much blood can be collected from a donor calculation? It's the same question.
Yes, sir. Repeated, sir.
So what is your opinion on auto transfusion pay surgery? Dr. Ranjita has asked what is the opinion on auto transfusion. This is one of the best transfusions to do because, for example, you have a dog which is with a big tumor inside, blah, blah. You can take blood from the dog and you can keep it for a minimum of 2 weeks on the fridge, inside the fridge, and then you can transfuse after the surgery. After a proper thawing, it works amazing. So there will be no cross reactions or any transfusion reactions if you do it correctly.
Thank you, sir.
So this is one more repeat question that we can skip. Santosh has asked, where can we get the cat typing kits, both from the same person? There are very few importers from the Europe and the US. And if you want to cut cost as veterinarians, if you want to cut cost on this, you can form a group and you can directly import. Because I have, there are two people who have, they are major players in the blood transfusion, blood typing kits. So you can email them. One is called Alvedia, A-L-V-E-D-I-A. You can go into the website. And if you want to get a lot of kits, you can avoid a distributor. Or if you are not bothered about money, if you want things done at your place, if you want someone to deliver in your clinic, then better go through a distributor.
Yes, sir. And I wrote the answer because, yeah.
And one more thing is, in Tanwas, we are actually researching on canine blood typing kits. This is the second year that's going. One and a half years more to go. If we successfully come with blood typing reagents, we can do it very, very low cost. So that will be our objective. So Indianized version of blood typing kit.
TP Parai is a donor. Have you checked about the Mudal, sir? Mudal of Karnataka?
Ah, yes, sir. The Mudal hounds also have a lot of DEA negative groups. So in my research before 8 years, we checked some 35 Mudal hounds because they were very rare. The normal original pieces were very rare. We checked 35 hounds, out of which we found a major proportion of them having DEA negative. So basically, hounds seem to have more of genetic traits, probably from the or probably from the Saluki, or probably from the Greyhounds. So they have DEA negative groups, and more importantly, for example, your Mudal hounds can be researched. Let us assume that you are going to transfuse a 20 kilo Labrador with another dog's blood. So you might only require 150 ml to 200 ml of a Mudal hound blood than 350 ml of a German Shepherd or a Labrador blood. The Mudal hounds have a high packed cell volume, more than 55 to 60. You won't believe. The Mudal hounds have more hemoglobin in them. You're talking about minimum of 16 to 18. Whereas if you take our Polish Labradors, healthy in atmosphere dogs, the hemoglobin will be 12
max. Yeah.
Okay. That's good, sir.
Thank you, sir. Good insight, sir.
Yes. So, cat kits, Dr. Surbhi Agrawal said, except normal saline, can colloids be given? No, blood itself is a colloid, so you cannot give blood, you cannot give any other things.
Yeah, so before that, there is also one question, like where can we get cat blood typing kits?
It's the same import. I gave you a number, no? Rajin.
Yeah.
So, Dr. Gurupreet has asked a beautiful question. You said don't go for ice pack application. So a lot of epicyclic cases we've been treating, and the general protocol, no, of immediately putting ice pack, putting tamponade, putting gauze into the nose, and giving antiseptics does not work. See, the dogs have something called a nasal plexus, which is very deeply seated compared to a human being. So you cannot touch that place, you cannot go up to the place, you cannot tamponade the place. So the ice packs have no effect on them. So the dogs have nasal turbinates. So instead of wasting time on that, or if you want the client to do some homework, well, fine, you just give him an ice pack so that he doesn't disturb you asking questions. He just keeps the ice pack for a long time. But if you want to do anything, you can go for vincristine, which is more common. It increases the bone marrow to produce more platelets by immunosuppression.
Great.
So that's a good question, Gurpreet. Can we give iron injection after blood transfusion? Okay, that's a good question. See, if you're talking about a CKD anemia, you can definitely give iron after a blood transfusion. If you're talking about non-iron deficiency anemias, you don't have to give iron.
So after transfusion,
Dr. Divya is asking how and where when we give the blood bags and blood transfusion set. So the blood transfusion sets, you can get it across your own distributor. So the blood bags, you will have to ask your higher ups, Dr. Parameshwar and Dr. Reddy, Nagesh Reddy. They will have to arrange from an association point of view, because that is very easy to do it instead of private practice individually getting blood bags, because they need an accounting, a nodal officer, a license. So that is very debatable.
Yes, sir.
Please explain cross-matching again. We've done it once more, Dr. Annie, and I think you can just watch YouTube videos on cross-matching. It will be very easy, and it normally takes a minimum of 1.5 hours. That is very difficult. So,
sir, then everybody can see a replay of the video what we have done today. They can see the entire video again, whosoever are the participants. Okay. So they can go through it again, no problem.
So I guess you can replay the video, Dr. Annie. Dr.
Yes,
Rajesh Babu, how much of volume can be collected from recipient? How much volume of blood can be collected from recipient? Now, if you are already the recipient is anemic, if you're going to collect blood, then things are going to turn ugly. So I think the question is wrong. Dr. Rajesh, you can retake your question, no issues. Dr. Surya, can we have the PowerPoint of major and minor cross matching? Yes, you can replay it again. Please explain the dosage of blood for dogs and cats in renal failures. See, remember, chronic renal failures, you have to anticipate anemia beforehand. You do not require a blood transfusion. When your dog is standing, singing and laughing, you can actually go ahead with iron and go ahead with erythropoietin injections weekly. That you can replay the PowerPoints, the doses there. And only for an emergency, you need to transfuse blood for renal failure cases.
Great.
Okay, Dr. Aishwarya, any time gap between vaccination and blood donations? Yes, a minimum of 2 weeks is required as a time gap between vaccination and blood donation. What rate of blood should be transferred? Dr. Samir, you can see the PowerPoint again, play it back. On a thumb rule, what I will say is 1 ml per kilo per hour for 30 minutes. Then finish off the transfusion, whatever might be the issue, within 3 hours. Do not delay. The initial 30 minutes is anticipation of any anaphylactic reactions. Dr. M. Chandrasekhar, for transfusion of blood in cats, is a cross-matching enough, or we will have to go with the typing? And why B-typed cats cannot be cannot donate for AB. Well, for transfection in cats, the cross matching alone is not enough. You need to type it and cross match it. If you're asking me why the antigens of the cats are very, very highly sensitive, so they react very badly. And why B-typed cat cannot donate for A-type AB cat? That's a good question. See, there are strong agglutins towards each B-type cat. So that is why majority we should avoid B-type for AB. And again, AB cat, till now I haven't seen one AB cat, so it's going to be rarest of rare. Don't bother much about that. So immunogenetics in blood transfusion is definitely a part where we lack, you and me. So the agglutins for B are more stronger. That is why you should not donate for AB cat. Thank you, Dr. Chandrasekhar. Grass Srinivas, can we transfuse blood directly from donor to recipient using high gradient without blood perfusion collection bag? Well, this is what we've been doing from 1860s. Well, if you want to do it, a lot of veterinarians on the field level, they say for cows, they have done that. And I really appreciate that. It can be done with the high gradient, not an issue, to answer your question. But now if you are talking about field condition, I think it's high time we upgraded the field condition. What is field condition? Field condition, we will be able to carry the small gadgets which I have shown you in the first couple of slides. So then you can use a hemocytometer to immediately see the blood hemoglobin. And immediately transfuse blood, you should need a blood collection bag. And I think for Dr. Srinivas, I have an answer. See, there is a company called Jorvet, J-O-R. Dr. Prakash, you can note it down.
Yeah, I like.
It's called Jorvet, J-O-R-V-E-T. So they deal with cattle blood bags. It's a 5-liter bag with CPDA. Both of them will be given separately. They can ship to you directly. If you order 10 bags or 20 bags, you can easily get it, not an issue, because it says for animal use only. So it is www.jorvet.com. Dr. Kishore Kumar, any blood group like universal donor and cat? Well, if you actually, technically I'll say no, because AB is very rare. Dr. Basanta, and any donor groups, universal donor groups in dogs and... Okay. See, now, if you are talking about a strict universal donor, then this dog should be negative for DEA 1.1, it should be positive for 4, it should be negative for other blood group like 3, 5, but there's a complete list. So on a field clinical level for our practice, if you have a dog which is negative for DEA 1, that is more than enough. We don't have to think of a universal donor. If it is our country's donor, that's more than enough. Dr. Sri Lakshmi, sir, could you please explain regarding the transfusion large animal practice? Okay. Shall I try sharing some slides for this?
Yeah, sir.
Okay, then. Just a minute. Yeah, in large animal practice,
we'll have to go through the action button again, sir, for sharing the slide. Enable screen sharing.
Yeah, what do I do?
In the action button, you have to go enable screen sharing again.
Yeah. So this is on, I added one slide here. See, in cattle, we have those 5-liter bags with CPDA. Is it visible, Dr. Prakash?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, so see how big the bag is, and you have a CPDA separately. So they also give I guess it's 15 to 16 gauge needle, which is sterilized, and you will have to do a jugular venipuncture as you do an IV, and you will have to collect blood in a weighing machine, or because it's going to be more than 5 liters. If you can take 5 liters out of a donor cow weighing somewhere around 300 kilos, that will be more than enough. You can take it and transfuse directly, because they do not require any blood typing on a first level. You're going to do second, third, or subsequent transfusions, you have to do a cross matching. And more commonly indicated issues for cattle will be, up to my knowledge, anaplasmosis and tularemia. Hope I answered your question.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Dr. Ankur, is it mandatory to grow for cross matching for the first transfusion? It is definitely mandatory for all transfusions, Dr. Ankur. Dr. Anil, how much sodium citrate we use for blood transfusion? Instead of sodium citrate, you can get something called citrate phosphate dextrose agar. That will be easy. If you want to do small procedures, you're talking about 2 ml of sodium citrate in 20 ml syringe. Approximate calculation. Okay, there's one better to say thank you. Dr. Manikant, I have seen vets using urine collection bag adding sodium citrate. Please suggest. So I've also noticed this. Only thing, you just have to sterilize the urine collection bag, it's the same. And you can add sodium citrate, not an issue. Yeah, so if you can get these large animal blood bags that are not very expensive. So I've already given the Borgat's website number. You can order online, Dr. Manikant. Dr. Ankur, is it mandatory? Yeah, it is mandatory, Dr. Ankur.
It's a repeat question, sir.
It's a repeat question. Dr. Adesh, how to reevaluate if blood is good for the transfusion? So there's something called RBC viability, Dr. Adesh, that requires a lot of in vitro testing. So I don't think it will be viable for you, only most on research basis. But what you can do is you can do a proper total count, WBC count. The total count TCDC will be more than enough, that you can evaluate that. And more importantly, the color of the blood should not turn brownish to blackish. That is very important. It should be red and bright red. That is an easy method to see. And if the blood lacks hemoglobin, you will see deterioration in the hemoglobin within 20 days. So then you cannot use it. So that's the best way to evaluate blood. Dr. Savita, sir, you please give the answer. You alone give the answer. Okay, I will alone give the answer. Krishna, type negative means DEA negative. Yeah, you're right. Type negative dogs, now we are looking at only DEA 1.1, not nothing else, because others is not important for us. Remember, DEA 1 is our enemy. Major, okay. I think it's a repeat.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
There are some repeat questions only.
Yes, so,
so after blood test, then we can do a blood test, sir, CBC.
For the source blood?
After blood transfusion, when we can do blood test?
Next day, 24 hours.
Within 24 hours?
Every day we do CBC, that is the only way to judge whether the dog is improving or not.
But within 24 hours?
Yeah. Is my screen still visible?
Yes, sir. Your screen is.
Now it's visible. Yes.
It's visible?
No, no, now it's visible.
So, yes, sir.
But it's empty slide.
I will put my number and this will be on WhatsApp. So if I get any good second opinions or anything that you actually require on you know, your cases, I can help you. That is not an issue. So this will be my WhatsApp number.
Yes, sir.
And the other one which I was saying was for the cattle blood bags. It's called Jorvet. So I guess it should be... You get most of the blood products online and they ship to India also. I don't know how they're going to do after post-corona, but I used to get from them. Is it visible, Dr.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, it's visible.
Yes. Yes, sir, visible, sir.
Okay.
So there are a few more questions, sir. Like, so should we proceed with them, or there are certain questions asked in the chat section? Should I ask you?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, sir. So in that,
this is the chat section.
Just start. Yeah, in the chat sections, but a random question has been asked, so they thought of the chat only. So there was a question like age limit and body weight, which I already answered previously, sir. So no need to answer it again. So like they have asked, Dr. Anjita Tiwari again asked, like, sir, according to your opinion on auto transfusion collected prior to surgery for any untoward outcomes. So she wants to understand your opinion on auto transfusion collected prior to surgery for any untoward outcomes.
Yeah, I think that's the best thing to do. Instead of giving blood from another dog, auto transfusion is one of the safest methods, provided you store them correctly.
Okay, sir. Then like there is like a question from Dr. Lalit. He's asking, can we give iron injection after blood transfusion?
Yes, you can give it. If it is a CKD related anemia or iron deficiency anemia, you can give blood iron after blood transfusion. It's not going to cause iron overload, no issues. And I have a question.
Yes.
This is for Dr. Parameshwar and Dr. Nagesh Reddy.
Yes.
So, see, we have this SAPAC association in Chennai, like how you have the PAPAC. So, a lot of associations are there in various states. Now, for getting these blood bags, now, if all the association heads can just represent in one letter to our whatever the heads, it could be animal husbandry, whatever, or Center for Drugs, or the Veterinary Council of India, so that there is some progress that can be made for a legal system of getting blood bags.
In fact, this issue was discussed in the EC meeting of FSA-PAI held at Hotel Hyatt, Mumbai, I remember. Am I right, Dr. Okay, Nagesh Reddy? This issue was discussed. It has been recorded in the proceedings also. And the EC members, especially particularly our president, Dr. Narendra, along with other, Makaran Chavan, all of them, I think they have initiated some procedure to acquire blood bags. They have written to VCI also, Veterinary Council of India.
Okay.
Is there any other route or any other source that we can tap at the state level, sir? At the state level,
see, that I think only for research you can get it, but basically the problem is in dispensing anticoagulant blood banks. So after this HIV issue, they have become very stringent.
Yes.
But what we should proceed is, we should have our own veterinary blood banks.
Veterinary.
See, for example, the same company that makes a human shampoo,